Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Okay, guys, I wanna go ahead and get started. We try to get going between 7 and 7.05 just so we have plenty of time for questions and answers at the end and more networking afterwards. I wanna start off by thanking everyone for coming. My name is Katie Maxwell, and I am part of Cohort Memphis here, but more importantly, I am the chapter director for Startup Grind, which is what all of y'all are here to participate in. To give you a little bit about Startup Grind, we're a global community. We are there to inspire and educate entrepreneurs in the various cities. We are in a little over 100 cities, 42 different countries, and we hold these type of events monthly in all of our chapters. So you can go to the Startup Grind website and you can check out what's going on in other chapters and actually view some of the events from those cities and kind of see what's going on. So I encourage you to do that. Our events are also uploaded to the Startup Grind Memphis page, so you can check out past events, keep in touch with what's going on for our future events, and we've already got our July and August scheduled, so we'll be getting more information out about those very soon. There are a few things that I want to make sure you know about Startup Grind, some of our core values. We are about making friends, not contacts. We want to help others before we help ourselves. And it's all about giving and not taking. And that's something that we really try to bring into these events that we do here and make it something that's good for everybody. We want startups to succeed within our communities. That's very important. And we want to make that startup journey a little bit less lonely and more connected for those people that are going through that. So that's kind of what we're about and what we're doing here. We have great partners within the city, which you'll see. Tonight we're going to actually have a few of them up here, so that's a good thing. And on that note, I want to introduce Andre, who is part of Startco. He is the co-president for Startco here in town, and Startco is all about growing the private and public investment for Startco and just for the startup world here in Memphis. And they're doing some really great things. So be sure, I'm going to throw you out there. Be sure and snag him afterwards if you have any questions about Startco. I'm sure he's happy to give more information and tell you more about what's going on. I'm going to hand it over to him, and we'll let him do a quick introduction for Brandon. But as part of Startco tradition, Startup Grind tradition, I need everybody to stand up, and we'll welcome Brandon.
All right. Thank you, everybody. Why don't you go ahead and have a seat. Yeah, give a quick little intro. I'm not going to get too much into specifics since we'll be up here talking for 30, 40 minutes with him. But Brandon was somebody that I met at a collaboration event that we were doing with the Memphis Public Library, where we're trying to leverage some of their small business resources to get more folks like Brandon to walk through the door and start taking advantage of resources. We were doing a speed pitch competition where people were coming in to pitch their ideas. And he just walked in and won. You know, he sat in for the little instructional right beforehand, took some notes, and then just walked in there and did it. And he was one of the winners. And then that led to us doing some one-on-one mentor sessions where we got to know Brandon and understand exactly who he is. And I think the key here is his determination. You know, it's very rare that you meet folks who will just come in and you tell them to do 5 things and they're done, right? You tell them to do 10 things with their business and it's done. And he just kept coming back for more. He was a sponge, he was absorbing it, and he was actually taking those real actionable steps into the community, which is hard to do, you know? And you're gonna hear a little bit more about what he's been doing in terms of having the confidence to walk into a retail store cold and build a relationship and get placed in that store. Very hard, a lot of people, they can't do that, right? And so I'm also happy of what Katie and them are doing here with Startup Grind and Cowork Memphis, because it's inspirational events, it's the network, it's the friendship that has more people like Brandon walking through the door. So let's give them a round of applause as well. So Brandon, why don't you first, just tell everyone what Guilt Free Pastries is before we start getting into the background. Just make sure everyone's clear.
All right. Well, Guilt Free Pastries is all natural, organic, grain free, gluten free. I can go on for days, so I am going to go on. Processed, that's what we're here for. Processed, sugar free, butter free, but not taste free pastry company. The very first recipe that I created was the avocado brownie. Took me about 12 to 20 different times to get it to hold together, because I'm not using any type of wheat or any type of things that bind together. It specializes in coconut flour is actually in that almond and avocado brownies. And from there, I just expanded the menu to about 10 different other items. There's brownies, cookies, dough. I actually make pizza dough, bread, and muffins. So that's basically guilt-free pastries in a little nutshell.
And this isn't just a business for you. I mean, this is your life.
Yeah.
I mean, when you talk about health and wellness, shed some light on your journey, right, in terms of health and wellness, weight loss, and why this is really a piece of you and not just a business that you're running.
Yeah. Well, I used to be 300 pounds, and I found that out May. I was 16 years old, went to the doctor. I was 300 pounds. They said I was in the risk of having diabetes, high blood pressure, cholesterol, all the stereotypical things that you get from eating a not-so-clean diet. And from that point on, I said I wanted to make a change in my life. That was May 1st, 2001. I went outside, cleaned up my eating, and by August, I was 175. And from that point on, 13 years ago, I said I'm going to make every day of my life better than I was the day before. And every day, ever since then, I've been doing exactly that. And I stumbled upon the fact of finding out that I was allergic to gluten, which meant that my love for pastries was out the window. And I wasn't going to have that, because if anyone who's ever struggled with weight loss knows, you have to keep something for it to be successful. And pastries was my one thing. So I cleaned up the pastries, and people started actually liking my avocado brines. I wasn't in this to make a business out of it at all. I was just really in to make a healthier living for myself and those around me. I mean, once I found out the brownie actually tastes great, I figured I can maybe give some to my friends and family. Other people started asking for it, and then that's where we went into starting where we are here today now.
And you have a lot of experience here. Maybe you can shed some light on, you know, Memphis, our city, has issues with this. Mm-hmm. You know, when you think about obesity and weight loss, maybe shed some light on your experience being in Memphis, using this craft of yours as an inspiration as well to many of the folks that you're coming across in this community.
Yeah, I mean, like Andre said, Memphis is a community that isn't known to be the healthiest community for food. I mean, it's known for great barbecue. I'm not going to knock that at all and other things. But for people who are looking for the more healthier end of the spectrum, Memphis is starting to get that around. So once I started with my avocado brines, I've tried my best to initiate it with other companies, other places, work with nonprofit organizations, try to get my products in places where it's not normally seen at, because my whole goal is to get my products to the whole Memphis community, not just to one section of the Memphis community, but to the entire community, and let everyone understand that you don't have to stop eating pastries when you're trying to get healthy. You can also incorporate healthy pastries, also taste great, into your diet as well.
Now, you just mentioned that you weren't trying to go into this to make money or turn it into a business, but now that you're doing it, what do you love about creating this food for people? I mean, what is it that makes you ecstatic to wake up in the morning?
It makes me very happy to wake up in the morning and actually hear someone say that, oh my God, I ate an avocado brownie and it wasn't green. And it actually tastes great. That's one of the most exciting things about it. You know, because most people think that, oh my God, I'm eating something gluten-free, it's going to taste like cardboard. But actually, and once they give me an opinion, because of course I'm going to always say it tastes great, because it's my recipe, of course. That's not being biased at all, but it's just what it is. But that's the one big thing that keeps me waking up in the morning. It lets me know, because I mean, it gets, truthfully speaking, doing this and not, because I really didn't plan for it, it's very difficult and it's very stressful. But getting up in the morning and actually knowing that I can actually touch someone else through what I do and what I love to do is a very inspirational thing and it's a great feeling for me to have.
Great. And maybe you can also share with us what made you at a certain point. There had to have been a trigger or something that went off in your head that said, I can do this, right? From a business standpoint. Mm-hmm. What took place?
Truthfully speaking, I really would have to give credit to my creators or my parents. My mother and my father, they're right there. They have instilled in me from ground up the spirit of there's no such thing as impossible or can't, and never be afraid of fear. And so from those three things, once I met you, or actually even before I got to you, one of my friends sent me an email, and he said, if you want to step outside your boundaries, here's the opportunity. And I said, why not just go conquer one fear? So every day when I wake up, I conquer a different fear every day. And this is actually one of them. And I'm here right now conquering that fear. So, thank you.
So you know, we have a lot of entrepreneurs or creatives in the audience here, and one of the things that I really admired about what you were doing is just having the guts to go out there and build relationships. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe you can describe, you know, how did you get it started? So you have this relationship with Miss Cordelia's downtown. Mm-hmm. You know, they're allowing you to leverage resources. You're selling product there. How did you start that?
Just from another word of mouth, someone literally told me your products are amazing. And the first place I could think about those being as Miss Cordelia's. I said, okay, I will go down to Miss Cordelia's and make a call to their executive chef and see if he had me in. He said, bring it in, let me taste it. And I walked in the door with no lead whatsoever. And just, he loved them, and we got going from there. So it was literally just me taking that first step of, because that's the one thing people don't do. They don't take the first step to actually try. You get a business card, you don't follow up on it. You don't even just give that person that first step. So what I always do is I literally will give them that first step. I will call, I will email, I will ask. You don't know anything until you ask. Right. And you can't be afraid to ask.
Sure. Yeah. And so you started there with mm-hmm. which products? Take us through now all the different products.
Okay. I started with Ms. Cordelia's with the avocado brownies. The chef really loved it at first. He had his the manager of the store, the general manager, come in. We had a second tasting before we signed the contract, and they actually loved the caramel avocado brownie and the cinnamon banana cookies. And from there, they started carrying those three products in their store. You want me to continue to other retailers or just?
Absolutely.
All right. From that point, I decided to, on Andre's advice, I decided to try to expand farther into Memphis. So I came to the Cooper Young area here and went to Stone Soup Cafe, which is right down the street here. Brought her my entire sample tray of everything. She really loved the vegan snickerdoodles, the cinnamon banana cookies, and the white chocolate chip cookies. So they started carrying those literally the next day. From there, I had a chance to meet Mr. Philip Ashley at a mingle. And I talked to him, told him what I was doing. He had me come out. He tried my brownies. He loved them for what he's doing at his shop. So now he utilizes my avocado brownies to give it a makeover and give it to Philip Ashley Chocolate's touch. From there, now I'm talking to a multitude of different other retailers. I can't really go into the specifics with those because we're still in conversations. There's about two other locations here in Cooper Young and one other location downtown called Tamp and Tap, which we will be carrying starting there this Thursday. They will be carrying my cinnamon banana cookies and white chocolate chip cookies there.
Good. So, you know, you're talking about, you know, basically what I call the grind.
Right? Yeah.
You're just going in and you're drumming up business. Talk a little bit more about, you know, you're doing a pretty good job of accessing local resources to help you. I've seen you in the community talking with people, having an open ear to advise. Why are you accessing all these resources? How is it helping you? And it seems to be working.
Yeah, it is. I mean, the way I'm accessing the resources is by keeping my ear to the ground, because just like you said, I'm grinding. And when you're grinding, you have to take every resource that you get, and you weed through the good and the bad, like you said, like a sponge. That's the way I live my life. I take every resource I get, I weed through the positives and negatives, and all the positives, I try to approach them that way. And so that's what I've been doing with my business as well.
And then where can the business go? Where do you think it could go? One, from, let's start with the growth of the business. Mm-hmm. But then also, I know we've had some conversations in terms of having an impact on the community. Mm-hmm. Just where do you think it can go?
From right now, I'm really looking forward to getting a kitchen, a storefront set up, and hopefully in an area where it's a middle section for the Memphis community, so everyone from different areas can come to it. So that's what I'm really looking forward to right now. From there, I would love to continue in building my base in retail. So, and then from there, hopefully one day turn Guilt Free Pastries into a restaurant. That's my biggest aspiration, owning my own restaurant, and not only serving the pastry end of it, but actually the whole health parameter.
Sure.
Yeah.
So in terms of entrepreneurship, you know, there's small businesses here in the audience, and we're always going through it. Having mentorship and guidance is something that always helps. But also, being able to leverage those mentors for what you need specifically also helps as well, versus just generic advice. How have you leveraged some of the people you've built relationships with, and how have they helped you keep focused and staying on the path?
Well, the first person I leverage is right here. So that's the very first. But besides that, I've spoken to many different mentors that I have, and they've allowed me into their kitchens, actually watch them do their operations, which is something that's from a chef point of view. Most chefs don't do that to strangers because of the aspects of that. Besides just showing me the way they do what they do, they've also provided me guidance with ways of different financial routes, ways to approach your market base in a better way, even learning the word market base, so to speak. They've taught me so much that I really would spend an hour here explaining every different mentor that I've met. I mean, I would not be where I'm at without my parents, without you, and without other mentors that I've met through this process in just 10 months' time.
So describe to us some of the mistakes you've made, right? Everything doesn't work out perfect. We make mistakes as we're growing the business. We have to start over again. Maybe you just name a couple, you know?
Okay. Besides the pastry end of it, I mean, half of the recipes that you see up there are seven different items there. Besides working on those 10, 20 different times, weeks after week, to try to get the recipe not only to be healthy, which is the easier part, truthfully speaking, but to actually taste good, because that's the most important part, the taste, and then the health. Besides that aspect, business end, front end of the house, I would say literally just going, sometimes cold leads cannot be the best lead. So that's one thing I'm learning now. Sometimes you can't just walk into somewhere and try to say, here, this is something great that everyone else, I think you should have. You have to maybe take the right processes. So that's one thing you have to do. Think before you leap sometimes. On the financial end of it, you should probably plan for a business first before just jumping into it, especially on the financial end of it. I mean, you should probably have something in the bank. I mean, I'm not saying have thousands of hundreds of thousands, because then it'd be maybe too easy. One, I know what to do with the money, but something in the bank, so that way when you meet certain people, you'd be able to utilize their assets in the proper way. So that's one of the things I would say you should always think about doing.
So let's stay on that. I know we've had a couple of conversations about you applying to get certain grants that can help the business. You know, maybe shed some light on those types of processes, because they're never easy.
No, they're not. Finding a grant and then actually applying for the grant and successfully achieving the grant is a very difficult process that I'm just now learning 10 months in. I was able to get one grant, and I'm already applied for it. Now I'm waiting to hear back from them, which is a very great grant for a startup business like myself to have. But just finding new grants, you have to meet the right people who know about the grants or go to the right sources to get the grants. Then once you're there, you have to make sure that you have every single detail. It's sort of like writing a term paper. And you have to have every single detail itemized and signed and everything they need before you submit it, and then just hoping that you will get the grant.
One of the things we always talk about is talking to customers, you know, before taking action on certain moves in the business. Yep. How's that gone for you? Getting out and talking to who your customer is, hearing their feedback and applying it to your business.
It actually helped a lot, because one of my pastries, the vegan snickerdoodle, the original recipe that I had for it, I thought was a great recipe, but as you told me to go out and test the market, I went out and talked to different people, maybe 25 to 50 different customers, random people that I did not know, and had them sample it. And from their perspective, I was able to take the notes they gave me and rechange the recipe and change some of the ingredients and to make it not even more healthy, but actually more tastier at the same time. Sure. So there's a great benefit of going out and speaking with the market.
And so if we're getting back here on the growth of the business, you mentioned you're going into a few different retailers right now, seems to be moving some of that product, but you talked about a storefront. How much traction do you think you need in terms of securing retailers before you can either secure the resources you need to get operating on a storefront? Right now, I think you mentioned a few, but what do you think it's going to take?
Ideally, I would hope to maybe be in about 15 to 20 different retailers first, so that way people are actually annoying me to the fact that there's not a storefront, to where a point where I know once I actually open up a storefront, the customers will come or the people will come. I don't like to really call them customers because I make a connection with them, but if we're using that word, I will say customers. But so the customer will come into the door that way. Outside of that, I mean, I would say maybe a time frame, maybe a year or two from now. I'm looking into some other aspects that Memphis. Memphis is a great city that offers opportunities to startups to actually have pop-up shops for free of charge on the startup. So I'm looking into those opportunities as well.
Well, good. You know, You know, in terms of impact on a community, we talked a little bit about that with obesity here in the Memphis area, mm-hmm. but really the South in general. Yeah. You know, do you think education plays an important role in your business?
Oh, yes. Education is a complete important role for my business because if I walk up to anyone and just, I was just speaking to these gentlemen about this lady and his wife before, or husband and wife before, yeah, that'd be weird, lady and wife. Well, actually, it's 2014, so it's not that weird. It's not. Yeah, it really doesn't. It's not. But, yes, we are. Walking up to someone and just handing them or just saying, hey, I have an avocado brownie. First thing people think about avocado is guacamole. So they think of green mush. So just saying those words is hard. So if you educate the person on the benefits of how healthy avocados are, the money saturated fats that avocados give you, the great healthy source of fat that avocado get, opposed to butter, even ghee butter. Otherwise, I'm not knocking anyone who uses ghee butter, but even ghee butter within itself. So just educating the people on that, and hopefully that, I hope one day I'll be able to get into the Shelby County school system and mentor some of the children and just show them what I do cook that way wise, so I can actually show them that food is the most important part first. Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Well, a big issue that a lot of startup businesses have, especially these types of businesses, is, you know, sometimes using your product as capital can help you get in the door in different places. You can partner with different events, you can, you know, spend all that time in the kitchen, but What are some of the mistakes and struggles around that? Because sometimes you don't get a return back, yeah. So you have to be strategic. Can you just talk about some of your experience and using your product to help you get through doors, but also maybe some where it didn't work out the way you planned?
Yeah, the first event I was asked to be a vendor at was an event that I could not sell anything at. It was just sample-based, and that was maybe 4 or 5 months ago, so I was 4 months in. So there, of course, there was no profit. I was 4 months in, so to me, that was me literally making a product and not seeing any revenue from it. From that, there was no other revenue that came in from the events. That was my first lesson. Because when I went there, I went with everything. I did not do any count of what I brought. I was just like, oh, I'm so happy I'm getting to go somewhere. I brought like 400 or 500 items. There was maybe 20 people there. So I wasted a lot of product. But from that point on, I've learned how to be asked questions, how many people are going to attend the event, ask certain questions that I would know what to bring to the event. And certain events now have been generating more buzz after the events in a more positive light.
And so I'm noticing, even with some of your good partnerships, you're still coming forward first, offering to help. You know, it's not just what can I get from you. Mm-hmm. So how does that work? And maybe give an example of a partnership that you have.
One of the partnerships that I had where I've actually given the product to the partner first beforehand was with Mr. Philip Ashley. I've actually given him, I don't want to say the amount, but I've given him an amount of pastries before just to let him test it out. Because there's no way, you don't want to go into business where you don't know if your clients are going to like what you're making. So I've given him products before. I've given almost every retailer I've been at here locally besides Miss Cordelia's, I've actually given them products to sell and for them to make their front end without me making any profit off of it. But just to show my faith that I'm really not, and I'm really mean this, I'm not in this for the growth of being the most successful entrepreneur, businessman in Forbes top 50. I'm in this for the love of what I do. I love making healthy food in general and pastries, and I love sharing it with everyone I meet.
So how does that work? You mentioned Philip Ashley a couple mm-hmm. times, another African-American guy in the city of Memphis doing great things with chocolate.
Yeah.
And here you are going to come to him and say, I want you to try my products. Most people would say, well, that's competition. Tell me how you look at that.
I guess you can say that's where my, I'm a social psychologist by academic training, so that sort of helps with talking to people. Because you learn how to speak with individuals all day to day. I did that for 9 straight years, so I learned how to talk to people. So when I was approaching Mr. Ashley, or Ricks, Philip, it was from the point of perspective that he's a chocolatier, and I'm a pastry chef. They're in the same universe, but they're on different dimensions. So, yeah, I'm a huge comic book person, so that's where I did nerd that up. Sorry, I'm a nerd. I am, and I love it. So that's where I come from. So when I spoke with Philip, it was on the end of, wow, you're making avocado brownies. So he was automatically interested in tasting because of what he does. He tasted it, he loved it, and he Philip being a great businessman and great citizen of Memphis that he is, he automatically knew what he can do with it, so it would not compete with him. And it doesn't compete at all, because they're two completely different entities within themselves. They both are chocolate, but they're completely different. So that's why they work so perfectly together, and they're right back there for everyone's enjoyment to taste that fusion.
Yeah. Well, you know, can't let you off the hook today. You know, have to put you on the spot a little bit.
Okay.
But since we have an audience here and they're learning about your business, mm-hmm. you know, tell them who your customer is. Who is your customer?
Right now? Right now my customer is young professionals, anyone between the age group of 21 to 45. Mostly what I've had contact with are more women around being my customers. Locally here in Memphis, the sector will be downtown, Harbortown, and Cooper Young are the main three sections that have been coming to me, actually calling outside of the stores and placing orders as well. So that would be my target. That's my market right now.
Sure. Yeah. And then, you know, what are the things you need? What do you need to continue to grow your business and to lay a foundation for you to be successful? What are the top three things you think that you need?
Guidance, of course. I'm going to say money for last, because that's too obvious. That's just the easy thing. If I had $100,000, oh my God, we'd be everywhere. No, we wouldn't, because I need to know what to do with the money first. That's the most important part. So that's why I said guidance first. Besides the guidance, of course, I'm a chef, so I'm always going to say the ingredients. The second, I have to need that. I need that, of course. And then money. You can't do anything in business without money. That's just the cold, hard truth. So, yeah.
And then maybe share with us, what are the top three things you're going to get accomplished in the next 90 days?
90 days? I'm going to be in three other retailers within the next 90 days. I'm going to be on TV within the next 90 days on local news channels doing features. That's going to happen. And the third thing is, I'm going to name it to claim it. I will have a storefront that's free of charge for me for at least 30 days within the next 90 days. Yeah. I said 30. Yeah.
And any advice you give, you know, for any up and coming business owners, if they're trying to go into the food space, the food industry, whether they're being a full-time chef or pastry mm-hmm. chef, any advice you could give to folks who are aspiring?
The first advice I would give is never quit. Don't let the stress that comes with this eat you alive. That's the very first thing. Use whatever mechanism you need to de-stress yourself. Use that mechanism wisely. That's the very first thing, the stress part. Outside of mental aspects of it, the actual working industry of it, I would say meet different people who's already doing what you're doing, because they know the struggles, they've been there. Outside of meeting those individuals, the third thing I would say to do is actually get whatever you're doing out there. So if you're a chef in a restaurant in the back of the house, try to ask the executive chef if you can maybe spice up the menu tonight and use just your item. If you're actually with your own product on a business end of it, get your product out there, go to different events that's happening, maybe come to Co-Work, Starco, ask, hey, can I just sponsor you or donate my products to you for free? So that way you would get some type of idea if people like what you do.
And then on a personal note, you know, what do you enjoy doing? What are your hobbies? Do you find time to get away and do different things? Share with us some personal notes.
Outside of cooking, I mean, food has always been my number one hobby. I was 300 pounds, like I told you. So, I mean, hey, food is my number one hobby. Outside of that, I do anything and everything my body allows me to do in the exercise realm. I CrossFit, I do aerobics. Hey, I do Zumba, so I keep my hips limber, you know. Mobile hips are very important in exercise. They are. I'm just saying they are. You know you want to do Zumba. I told you to come to Zumba one time. It is fun, see? Outside of exercising and eating, I read and I watch movies. Besides those four things, I really do love to help other people when I can. That's something that I really do love to do. So if someone needs help with training, I train. If someone needs help with what they're eating, if they want to know if it's clean or not, I will provide nutrition help with individuals. My hobbies are anywhere I need to be, anywhere where faith leads me in a positive aspect. Those are my hobbies. I try to become the best version of myself I can be daily, and use that best version to inspire other people and help other people.
know, and let's take that a step further. You know, we're in Memphis.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of folks out there who say this or say that about Memphis in a negative way, but you seem to be embracing it in a positive way, not just personally, but for your business. So why Memphis?
Well, the easier reason is because I was gone from Memphis, honestly. I was in graduate school, and I never really planned on coming back, to tell you the truth. I plan on coming back, but not to relocate permanently here in Memphis. But my father went ill, and he lost his leg due to diabetic complications, and my mother needed help. And there was no other question about that. I was coming back. And once I came back, I've noticed that the food industry in Memphis did change, but it still wasn't. My eating habits got healthier, and I couldn't eat out. That became a struggle when I learned that I was allergic to gluten, and I couldn't come out and share my finances with the Memphis community and keep Memphis growing. I couldn't eat anything, so that was the biggest struggle. So from there, I just figured out, you know, I said, if I can't eat it, I'm going to make it available to everyone else. So that's where we're at now.
And so take that a step further. Elaborate on conversations that you're having with other chefs, other restaurateurs about Memphis obesity, gluten-free items. How are those conversations going?
They're going pretty well, because what we're noticing now is gluten-free is actually making its way to the Mid-South. You see a large amount in different retail stores, different grocery stores, you see a gluten-free aisles. And the restaurant area, all the restaurants now understanding that they need to cater to that market. That's the way they're looking at it, but they need to benefit those people who do have gluten sensitivity, celiac disease, gluten intolerant individuals, or individuals who just want something else besides the stereotypical Memphis food, which is a good soul food, your ribs, your barbecue, your macaroni and cheese, your collard greens. Hope no one's getting hungry right now for me saying all this. And your healthy foods like your Greek salads and, you know, not eating all the meat all the time and things of that nature. So, yeah, they're getting to come back to that. I go back and forth a lot. But to come back to that, they really are. When I speak to different restaurants from downtown out to east, out to Cordova, they're all understanding that this is 2014 and Memphis is becoming a healthier city as well, for the better.
I'm hearing a little diversity in your product. So you were talking about, you know, brownie avocado with avocados in them, but then pizza dough, right? How diverse do you think you can be with the guilt-free pastries?
Oh, me? Mm-hmm. like I told you before, there's no limit. I don't believe in a limit to my imagination at all. I was never taught to put myself in a box, so I don't live in a box now even. I live in every box. I mean, every box and no box all in one. So with my pastries, there's no limit to guilt-free pastries, because ideally, guilt-free pastries will turn into a guilt-free company, not just pastries. And with those pastries, I'm already working on 5 different pastries right now. Okay. Yeah, new recipes.
What would you like to do? I mean, is there something out there when you drive by that restaurant or that place, light bulbs go off in your head? Is there a collaboration that you think would be amazing that could really launch your business forward? I mean, what would you want?
Like I told you, I'm a huge fan of I've been a huge fan of comic books, and movies. Yeah, it's a whole long time. And the ideal spot I can see every time I ride by is the movie theaters. And the reason for that is because anytime you go into a movie theater, you're paying 10, 12, 14, 15 bucks for some popcorn and a soda. Both of those two things are very dangerous for you, by the way. Soda is just full of sugar and high fructose corn syrup. And the popcorn they use there is just sugar and air. It's no good for you, and grains. So when I ride by a movie theater, the first thing I think about is, why wouldn't they serve healthier foods? And that's my biggest struggle right now. I'm already talking to the local movie theater here, their VP of concession stands, trying to wiggle him around to see that you need to put healthier foods in the concession stand, because people would pay the prices, you know, but why would you want to pay so much for just popcorn and a huge Coke? I mean, that's like 3 pounds of sugar.
We seem to be quite knowledgeable on what we should be putting into our bodies. So if you had to give the audience here, you know, 4 or 5 recommendations of things they could tweak to their routine, what would they be?
So you understand we're in Memphis, right? I mean, I don't want to get beat up when I tell people to stop doing certain things. I mean, you can protect me. You can protect me. Okay. One. All right. We'll see. We got trained people in here. One would be bread. stop eating bread. I mean, bread is, I know, right? Yeah, bread is hidden, especially when you eat white bread. Or there's no such thing as whole grain bread, first off. I mean, do you Google that? There's no such thing as whole grain bread whatsoever. Just research what a whole grain really is. So bread is A. Soda, in general, that's the second one. I don't care if it's Coke. Diet Coke's terrible for you. It has a farmate in it. It eats brain cells. It's dangerous for you. So that's bread, Coke. I won't say pork, but I will. So pork. And if you're going to eat red meat, eat grass-fed beef. But the three I would say cut out, which are extremely hard to do, but once you set yourself to it, they're easy to do. Bread. I don't know why I sound like a 13-year-old then. Bread. It's like bread. It went up. Bread, Coke, and pork. I hope Corky's, anyone else, doesn't see this and try to put a assault on me, but pork, yes, pork. Yeah, those are the main three I would say off the bat to stop doing, yeah. Oh, I'm sorry.
Sugar and butter.
Thank you. Fried foods and processed sugar, yeah, which is why I said stay away from the Cokes and the bread, because bread and Coke, I mean, anyone knows this now. We all know this 12-ounce can of Coke has probably that much processed white sugar in it. I just said processed and then white sugar. So stay away from processed sugar as far as you can. And butter is okay if it's ghee in small amounts, but it's just safe to stay away from it. Switch it to avocado. You can do everything with avocado you can do with butter easily within 5 minutes.
What about beef?
Grass-fed.
Yeah, grass-fed. Yeah, grass-fed, yeah. No, I've never. Yeah. Oh, that person right there speaking, I don't know if you guys can hear him. He said, what about beef? And he actually knows so much about me. It's like very freaky and maybe stalkerish, but it's not because he raised me. So it's okay for him to know everything about me. That's my father, by the way. Give it up for him, real. But like he said, I've never eaten red meat, any beef before. So that's something that I say. That's a personal thing that I do. It's not for any reason. I just never tried beef before. I never tried it, so I just don't eat it. But if you're going for beef, meats in general, then yes, any lean meat, and beef, it would be grass-fed beef, chicken, turkey, and fish. Yeah.
So before we take a few questions, you've been talking about this storefront and this location that you would love to have. So walk us through it. We walk through the front doors of Guilt Free Pastries. Mm-hmm. What's our experience going to be?
It's the vibe, I would say, be a modern with a hippie twist, so to speak, or not a hipster, but more of a hippie line, because everything is green, as you can see. You would walk through the door, there'd be one, maybe two small boutique tables to experience the Guilt Free lifestyle there in the storefront. Also, there'd be a nice, really earthy display. I'm a visual person, so I see everything, so I'm actually letting you guys see what I'm saying. Just use your imagination. So it'd be a nice display here with a clear front, of course, to see all the pastries. There would be a kitchen for a demonstration so I can actually show and run classes so I can, like I told you before, come back, have the schools come out to the kitchen, let the kids see what it's like to be in the kitchen, have a demonstration kitchen, and then the kitchen in the back, and a little location or a small wall space for all the local businesses and small businesses to show support there.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
Sounds good. Any questions for Brent?
Yes, sir.
Well, this is more of a comment than a question. I like the fact that you spoke about perfecting your craft before going to market. And you talk about the hours and the days and the weeks and the months that you spent working on each recipe to make sure that they are right. And I really want to emphasize that because a lot of times in Memphis you see people and they rush to create a product or they rush to offer service before they perfected their craft. And I think we can tell from eating your wares tonight that you put in a lot of work in perfecting your craft, and I think that's a really great thing.
Thank you. So you want to rephrase it before the camera?
Well, it was more of a comment, so.
Yeah, all right, okay.
Any other questions? Jennifer?
Okay, I know that you talk a lot about retail store in Memphis and really hitting the Memphis community, especially with the kids and everything. So what are your plans for expanding beyond Memphis? Where do you see yourself in maybe 5 to 10 years? What does that look like for you, getting out there into different cities and expanding beyond Memphis?
Just so everyone heard, she's talking about expansion outside of Memphis, impacting the community and growing larger.
Right now, I'm already in talks with individuals in Texas. It's a company called Three Snares. That's a production company, but they're one of their production managers is also huge in the food industry, within the farmers markets and things like that. So I'm in talks with Texas, with Austin, Texas in general, to try to maybe distribute there within the future. That's in the future, like you said, 5 years now. Also, I'm in talks with other distributors actually I've met through social minglers, who are distributors for areas like Atlanta, Florida, and California, which are all healthy locations. So I'm keeping those contacts very warm every day, every month, so keep them warm, you know, and then hopefully within 5 to 10 years now we'll be, or Guilt Free Pastries on the other hand, will be in other markets outside of Memphis. But my main goal is to help Memphis first and then spread from there.
Thanks for sharing, first of all. Thank you. I also want to talk about, you've addressed some of the marketing aspect of your business, the grind, being on the street and getting in front of customers. What about the operations side of your business? So from a supply perspective, how you handle inventory, whether or not you need to bring in additional people, particularly as your product is a very fresh product, but I'm assuming you can't have a long shelf life.
Yeah.
How do you handle those kind of things?
And his question is really more on the operational side of things, in particular inventory and that management.
With the inventory point of end, I use almond flour and coconut flour and basically almost everything. I customize what I make to the customer. So if you had a problem with a nut allergy, which are almond and coconut flour nut allergies, if you had a problem with that, I will make something special for you. But what you're talking about for the items you see here, of course, I buy in bulk. Everything is made fresh upon order. So there's nothing being sitting around anything, of course, that end. Also, operational wise, I try my best to buy the ingredients with what I can, what I have, and buy from that point, and then cook them when the orders come. If that answers your question. If not,
Made to order.
Yeah, everything is made to order and customizable. I mean, the avocado brownies, they have white chocolate chips in them. If you call me tomorrow or tonight and say you didn't like white chocolate chips on your order, I would take that out and customize it especially for you. Everything is based off your palate with a healthy twist. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
So where do you like to get your ingredients and people that do sell you your ingredients, do you have any kind of agreement with them? Do they know what you're creating and that you're starting up, and are they like sponsoring you in some form or fashion?
So she's asking about where is Brandon getting his ingredients and what's the relationship that you have with those suppliers?
All right. Most of my suppliers, especially for the flour end, I buy locally through other small businesses. And no, they're not sponsoring me whatsoever with the ingredients. I pay full retail price for those, but I'm still generating a small business connection and helping other small business out, which is important. Outside of stuff that I can't find small business wise, I have to go to the box shops, the healthier ones. I don't want to mention their names. The healthier ones here in town, which we both know what I'm speaking of. Yeah, I go to those and purchase my products from them and buy in bulk.
Would you mind sharing the names of the small businesses?
Oh, yeah, no problem. The small business, she asked, do I like to share the name of the small business that I get my ingredients from? The small business that I get all my flours and spices from is John's Pantry in Cordova, Tennessee.
Cool.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But it also reminded me of the story of the guy who started Chipotle. He wanted to have a very high-end, fancy sit-down restaurant, but realized that this other thing he was doing turned out to be much, much more lucrative. So if you find this path that turns out to be super lucrative, are you ready to let go of the restaurant idea or expanding into other types of foods and just focusing on these amazing, delicious, healthy pastries?
I like the last part.
And so, you know, Brad's question was about, you know, there's this original vision of having this restaurant, but what if the business tells you otherwise?
Yeah, I mean, my original vision for my career in life was to, truthfully speaking, be a behavior analysis for the FBI. That was my original dream, and we see where I'm at now, right? So Yeah. So basically, to answer that with the restaurant thing, I mean, that's my dream right now, is to own my own restaurant and have a full guilt-free experience within that restaurant. But if I see, like you said, there's more beneficial reasons outside of just the lucrative part, but more so of helping people, because that comes first for me. I know that's probably what people don't, that's one thing I'm always going to struggle with, is being now a businessman. Helping people comes before money in my mind. Always have, always will. So if there's a route where I can be helpful to my customer base and lucrative at the same time, and faith leads me in that direction, I will follow the tides and go that way. If not, I will stick to what I have planned. So it really just based on faith.
Did you have number four?
You kind of answered it. I was going to ask you, if it came down to selling your product or teaching people how to make product for themselves, what would you rather do?
So the question is about selling product or teaching people how to make the product. Mm-hmm.
I do both now. I actually do teach people now how to make my product. I do come into people's homes and I actually teach them how to make certain products. Not necessarily my brownies, but I teach them how to make healthier pastries and other desserts. So I do that now. So if there's a split between the both, I would never split them, because teaching individuals is very important. So I wouldn't split them. Yeah, you will.
We'll start back here.
Yeah, back
raise
back.
Your hand for a little.
Yeah, Brandon, you mentioned earlier in the conversation you were 300 pounds. And now, obviously, you're in the best shape of your life. The doctor gave you a prognosis that you had to make a lifestyle change, not a diet, but a lifestyle change. So you had to give up guilty brownies, I guess you could call them. And give up ice cream, all the stuff that
everybody yep.
And you was kind of in a bind. Could you have achieved your goal of this healthy lifestyle without developing your avocado brownies and products such as that? Basically, could you have enjoyed, you said you'd like to eat, could you have enjoyed that lifestyle?
Mm. Basically, he's talking about Brandon going from 300 pounds to the way he is now, had to make a life choice. If your products did not exist or could not exist, would you have been able to
enjoy the same
life and move forward and still accomplish these lifestyle goals?
Well, obviously I would enjoy life and move forward outside of pastries. I mean, that's not my whole life, eating pastries, but I mean, of course that's not. But besides that, to answer your question, no, because right now I've just recently started a new challenge with one of my friends. For next 30 days, we're not eating pastries. And so that's easy to do for me because I cook them all the time. Actually, it's a little bit harder because I literally cook pastries all the time. But out here in the environment, in Memphis-wise, it's so easy for me not to eat pastry because they're so, I hate to say this, bad. Outside of certain local small businesses that I've already spoke about before. But other places, they're not as great as they are. So if I never created what I created, to answer your question, I probably would not eat pastries today. Yeah, just to be truthful with you, because I probably would be overeating them still and not being able to control myself from eating them out. So that my pastries allowed me to continue along, be bettering myself daily. Yeah.
So you haven't been in business a year yet, but you were featured in the Memphis Flyer, so you did print, and now you're here. How did you learn about this opportunity? Did they come looking for you?
Talking about some of the coverage that he received in the Memphis Flyer, not being around a year yet, how'd you do it?
Everything, for some reason, has been coming to me, literally. I'm not for sure because I'm being positive with every aspect of my life, and positive comes back. To answer the question specifically, I got in the Memphis Flyer. I was actually on the road, but doing one of those things you said before, hobbies. I was actually driving. I love to drive. I was driving to Nashville, actually. And I had a call from the Memphis Flyer editor, and she said a reporter will be calling you to sit down and do a write-up on you. So that's how that happened. Here in Startup Grind today in Cowork, I actually walked in with the executive director of an organization called WIN, which is local here. And we were looking, or she was looking for something for her own organization. And she happened to literally ask Katie, do you guys do anything for startups? Katie said, yes, Cowork, and we have a thing called Startup Grind Memphis. I don't know why I'm acting like this is her voice. This is not her voice, by the way. I don't know why I do that. I have a problem doing voices sometimes. Let me go back to my regular voice. Katie said. Katie literally just said that, yes, they love working with nonprofit, small startup businesses. And from that point on, she said, wow, look, the June, we have a spot open for June. And she said, do you want to feel it? I, of course, was a little bit like this, but she couldn't tell. But I said, I'm going to conquer this fear. And I said, why not? And now I'm sitting here. So.
Let's grab this one. Talking about time management, and when Brandon first came to an event that was held at the library, you know, was he still working a full-time job, and is he still working a full-time job now?
When I came back to Memphis, my full-time job and my own responsibility and my mindset was to take care of my parents, help my mom take care of my dad, and in turn teach her as a caretaker how to take care of yourself. That was my full-time job. I cared about nothing else. Fortunately, I did have some savings, so that allowed me to cushion. When I met Andre and Starco via the library, I was already 100% in as going to Guilt Free Pastries. And now I'm currently, this is my full-time job. This takes up 30 hours of my day. Wait, there's only 24 hours in a day. Sorry, 24 hours of my day is Guilt Free Pastries. Right here.
Well, first of all, I'd just like to say, Brandon, you are an inspiration.
Thank you.
And thank you for living your dream and doing, having the courage and the confidence to go out there and do this every day. And to, you know, like you said at the very beginning, taking that first step is just a huge thing, and you did that. And I was just wondering if you're willing to share. I also know that when we do that, when we're out there sort of doing that, we do those moments, we show that courage and that confidence and those things moment by moment. Mm-hmm. It's not always part of some grand plan or scheme. We like to think there may be, but a lot of times it's moment by moment. And you've mentioned some things about your philosophy and your values that you have, and to the extent that you're willing to share that, I'd really be curious to hear about your inner approach. We know about your outer approach and what you've been able to do, but about your inner approach to life and how you manifest this.
And so the question was just, we had heard about how he's going through things on a day-to-day basis business-wise, but internally, what are some values, some things that you can share with us that maybe we can learn from?
I mentioned it briefly before, but literally the way I live my life is that I try to listen to everyone around me, be it positive or negative. Even if you listen to a negative person, 1 out of 10 things is still positive. So if you didn't listen at all, you would have missed that one thing. So I try to listen to everyone around me, and I'm like a sponge. I really like, not SpongeBob, but I'm like a sponge. I squeeze out everything, and I keep the positive, and I let go of the negative. So that's literally, in my life, in a nutshell, is that I take out the negative and keep the positive, and I try to, from that positive, turn that around and help others when I can.
So this is talking in terms of making Memphis healthier and Brandon's vision for that, and what's the strategy in terms of lower income, the underserved community who really need this type of advice and thinking?
Right now, my strategy is, in my mind, is very simple, so it could not be, but it's simply, my product is a premium-based product. It really is. It's a premium organic product, so all on my front end is extremely high to make the product. I sell it in 4, 8, and 12 packs, and the price point are reasonably base. If someone was to come to me from any area of Memphis or any economic status, and they said they couldn't afford maybe a 4-pack, but they really wanted to start a healthier lifestyle, I'll have a sliding scale. That's the easy way to put it, a sliding scale for each individual who comes to me. If they have a certain economic problem and they can't afford maybe the 4-pack, we can work something out for 1 or 2 pastries or something until they can get to the point where they need to. The most important part is getting them to a healthier lifestyle. It doesn't, I would love it to be a guilt-free lifestyle with guilt-free pastries, but if they need me to help consult them nutrition-wise and go that in and help them learn things of that aspect, I would do that with them as long as they're getting healthier. And then maybe, hopefully, incorporate some guilt-free pastries in their life, then that's the way I'm approaching it right now. So, simple.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to know, once you get established real good, do you think you'll be able to box and sell your soup? You know, you make two or three soups also.
So the question is, once we're doing well, mm-hmm. are we going to enter into the guilt-free soups?
Yes, I've already, that's, I know, right? You're just leaking all the secrets out. Since he's leaked one secret, let me tell you everything I do that's guilt-free. Everything I eat, 98% of what I eat all week is I cook it myself. So that's soups, salads, anything baked in the oven you can think of, pizzas, lasagnas, pastas, anything. I make it completely scratch. I make it guilt-free. I mean, not guilt-free, grain-free, gluten-free, processed, sugar-free, butter-free, all of it. Everything I do that way. So that's why I said hopefully once I get on my own restaurant, the entire menu will be guilt-free from the appetizer all the way to the dessert, from the beginning to the ending.
Just have time for maybe one or two more.
Okay, I tried to make some gluten-free cornbread yesterday, and man, it just was not good old Southern cornbread. So I could use some coaching. Anytime you got mm-hmm. some suggestions or whatever on gluten-free cornbread.
Vegan, yeah, gluten-free, egg-free cornbread.
All right, that's not hard. I make a, you want to rephrase it when we go ahead?
Oh, they want to know about gluten-free cornbread. Any suggestions he can give?
Yeah, right now I make a gluten-free, grain-free, vegan bread. Actually, that's on the menu. The vegan is not on the menu yet, but I actually make a vegan for myself. That's one way you could turn that into a cornbread. If you like to talk out the words, I can give you more information about it, and maybe you can share what you used that didn't get your cornbread the way you wanted, and I maybe can help you with it. Yeah, but not on camera. Yeah, can't share all the trade secrets, you know. Right, the wrong way, not the trade secrets, there we go.
So maybe in closing, you can maybe give your commercial. Because what could they be doing to support you?
What you guys can be doing to support me is everyone order something tonight. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, it'd be back orders, but you get it within a week or two. I promise. It'd be fresh still. I promise. Besides ordering tonight, you can easily find me on any social media site. There's Facebook. Facebook and Instagram is the company name. That's Guilt Free Pastries. Twitter is at GFP_2013. There is a website coming around pretty soon. Once I speak with the right people and get everything squared away, there will be a website coming along. So don't type in guiltfreepastry.com just yet. But go to all the social media sites. You can find everything about me there. The menu is there as well. You can always give me a call. It's 901-326-8482. That was a shameless number plug. Yes, it was.
What were those locations again?
The locations you can find us here recently is Miss Cordelia's in Harbor Town, and in this Cooper Young area here is Stone Soup and Phillips Ashley Chocolates. And starting this Thursday, it's going to be in the downtown area, Tampa Tap. Yeah. Thank you.